Hashtag in the beef. Hashtag give them what they want. Hashtag never gonna happen. What's up, everyone? We're gonna talk about a possible Dark Lotus reunion today, right after the intro. We ain't gonna rob by accident. It's only a select few that can handle this. Freak shit, apparition of a poltergeist. Blessed with a heart, but it's cold as ice. It broke it twice. Check it out, everyone. I'm Trey Baird. It's Magic Ninja Monday, and we are here today to discuss the possibility of a Dark Lotus reunion. The year is 2019, and the last time we saw a Dark Lotus album was, I don't know off the top of my head, it was 2014. It's been 5 years from now. So, yeah. ICP and Twiztid do not get along anymore. And that was the original inspiration for Dark Lotus in the first place. Twiztid came aboard Psychopathic Records, and everyone wanted to do a project together. Everyone wanted to do a supergroup. And originally, it was originally going to be just ICP and Twiztid. And then Blaze was added, and they decided to add a sixth member so that it could correspond, I guess, with the six Joker's cards. Because Dark Lotus, you know, it was always about ICP and their mission. Dark Lotus was just a support group to enhance the six Joker's cards, if you will. So they came out with this album, Tales from the Lotus Pod, in the year 2001, I believe. And previous year, ICP put out the Czar Bazaar as a prelude to the Six Jokers card, and the Six Jokers card actually came out in 2002, the Wraith, Shangri-La. So Dark Lotus was conceived originally as just being kind of like a warm-up to the sixth, if you will. And the original gimmick was, you know, six Joker's cards come and go, and it's the end of the world. So Dark Lotus originally had something of a apocalyptic nature to it, which can be reflected on the opening track of their debut album, Alibaba, you know, No Apocalypse of the Seven Churches, which is also hinted at in the intro to Bazaar, where the only, this gigantic storm cloud forming over Detroit that's growing and covering the entire country, if you will, and the only light piercing the cloud is falling on places of worship, all religions, all denominations. I don't understand half of this stuff, but you have the pyramids here in the liner notes for Tales from the Lotus Pod, along with this secret message right here in hieroglyphics, which I think is telling people to meet them behind St. Andrew's Hall or something at a certain time. You know, I don't know about all that. And here, behind the CD, you have instructions for a seance. I mean, this is the way they built up this original Dark Lotus album. It was basically, you know, real magic on the CDs, and they even claimed they had to go back and change some of the lyrics because it was too real. Yeah, this is the type of marketing that you only get from old school Psychopathic. They, you know, they just don't do anymore. They're trying to get back to it, I think. You know, I don't really consider myself a fan of Psychopathic Records anymore, and it kind of breaks my heart to say that, but I feel like they're trying to get back to that mindset, that marketing that made them popular in the first place. Of course, they're not hungry for success anymore. They become a little complacent. Maybe now that they're on a downward slope, maybe that'll reignite the fire in them to actually put effort into what they're doing again, but I digress. This is supposed to be about a Dark Lotus reunion. So, yeah, back to the subject at hand. I don't think it's going to happen. Like, if it does happen, it won't be anytime soon. Like, easily not within the next 5 years or so. I just don't see it. There's tensions are too high on both sides. You know, Twiztid likes to act like they don't care, but they do. You know, I believe that Twiztid were deeply hurt and upset by the fallout, and I think where it comes down to for ICP, I think that they were hurt and upset as far as the aspect of, you know, they don't control everything. They're not the gatekeepers of the subculture anymore. They're no longer, I mean, they're still top dog, but only in the sense of how they can move units and sell tickets. That's the only area that they're the top dogs anymore, because they used to control everything. They used to hold people back who were a threat to their dominance. They used to put people in check and in their place all the time. And now that Magic Ninja has emerged and it's given, you know, the artists and the fans an alternative to the Hatchet Man, now, you know, ICP, they don't like the change that's happened in this subculture. They like to be in control. Really, this comes down to, you know, the Bruce Brothers and not many others. It's the Bruce Brothers who are, you know, causing this power imbalance, and always has been. And I have a lot of respect for Jump Steady, you know, Robert Bruce, Jay's brother. I have a lot of respect for him in the sense that he's a Gulf War veteran. You know, my dad was career Army, Vietnam veteran. I believe in supporting the troops, even if you don't agree with the mission. You know, I always believe in supporting the troops and supporting veterans. I can disagree like 100% with them as people, with their politics, with the mission even. But if you're willing to put your life on the line to protect our freedom, you have my respect regardless of everything else. Now, with that said, you know, I think that, you know, for the most part, Violent J is the problem. He's the person who got all this rolling, but he's also the problem. And I think that Jump Steady has been enabling Jay to create these problems and to perpetuate them. So I don't necessarily think Shaggy is at fault here, except for the extent that he's loyal to a fault and he will co-sign whatever stupid shit Jay is doing at the time. Now, is the fact that Dark Lotus is not going to reunite, is that all Jay's fault? No, of course not. You can't, for anything, you can't ever place the blame squarely on one person. You know, this is an argument, this is a dispute, and it takes two sides to have a dispute. So, I can't, you know, rationally blame Psychopathic and Violent J for everything. But, you know, I'm a longtime follower of this culture. Yeah, I no longer identify by the word Juggalo, but I don't have an issue with Juggalos. I still have love for real Juggalos, but, you know, if all you are is an ICP fan, you know, you are, by their definition, by ICP's definition, you are not a Juggalo. You're a fan. You know, Juggalos are supposed to be open-minded. You know, even Shaggy said in the Fago Lovers interview, and they've said this many times before, there are Juggalos who don't even listen to ICP. So, this is, you know, a dispute that, or, you know, this semantic wordplay on what is and what is not a Juggalo is irrelevant, because your cult leaders say that you don't have to be an ICP fan to be a Juggalo. Blah, 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 blah. Anyway, so, what aspect do I hold Twiztid responsible for this situation? Truth be told, Twiztid could probably be a little bit more, you know, humble and a little bit more willing to, you know, meet in the middle here to make a Dark Lotus reunion happen. Now, here's the thing, I don't even want a Dark Lotus reunion. You know, I am perfectly fine with Dark Lotus being Twiztid and Blaze. ICP were, in my opinion, always the weak links of the group anyway, especially Jay. But, there was a period of time, I want to say around 2008 to 2000, maybe a little earlier, it was between the two sets of Joker's cards, I think that Shaggy just kind of fell off. You know, the last Joker's card of the first deck was in 04, and the first Joker's card of the second deck was in 09, and that was the time I think Shaggy just kind of lost direction in his career, And I think that he was phoning it in for especially side projects such as this. So the Opaque Brotherhood came out in 2008, I believe it was. Yeah, the Opaque Brotherhood. And this is not Shaggy's best work. Like, some of the tracks are good, but then there's others where he's just obviously, he obviously doesn't give a shit what he's doing. You know, he's probably drinking. You know, I lose track of whether he's on the wagon or off the wagon. But I'd say it's pretty safe to say that he was off the wagon when they were producing this, because some of his work is just downright sloppy. And I mean, you name a Dark Lotus album and Jay kind of like drags it down, especially the first one. But I think he's also pretty weak on the last one, Mud, Water, Air, and Blood. This was the only Dark Lotus album to happen after the split. So, and you know, which is another thing. There's not a Magic Ninja logo anywhere on here. It's not mentioned. You know, it just says Psychopathic, and that's kind of bullshit if you ask me. Because three of the five members on this Dark Lotus album were signed to Magic Ninja when this album was produced. So Psychopathic Records, my ass. You know, whatever. And that's another reason why I don't particularly care to see a Dark Lotus reunion, because, you know, this right here, the Mud, Water, Air, and Blood, I think it's their weakest album. You know, it has a few bangers on there, like Garden of Evil, their opening track, is cool in sort of a Nightmare Before Christmas type of way. That's what it reminds me of. It sounds like some Tim Burton shit. And then the album just kind of goes downhill after that. There's a few standout tracks, but for the most part, it's just, I'm not feeling it. And the closing track is pretty cool, Let It Rain. You know, I like the concept of that. You know, everything, the desert, everything's become a desert, we need rain. And it's a metaphor for, like, the state of the Juggalo world. Like, you know, we need people to step up and create stuff for the Juggalo community to enjoy. You know, the scene is kind of dying off, not just the Juggalo scene, but independent music in general. And we need to support what's out there. Let it rain, in other words. Let nourishment come for those who are struggling. You know, good concept. I like it. And conceptually, the album is good. Execution is another thing. And I think that's from the, you know, tensions that were brewing behind the scenes at the time. Honestly, it probably would have been better if Twiztid had just emailed them the verses instead of, you know, getting them all together. And, you know, Violent J is this huge extrovert, and he's kind of, like most extroverts, he's kind of intolerant towards people who are not extroverted. You know, everything is meetings and get-togethers and all that stuff, you know. Which was a big point of contention behind the scenes at the time, because Jay wanted to still be able to summon Twiztid, even though they were no longer on the label, to just come whenever he wants them to and attend meetings and stuff. I think that if he was willing to work with artists around their schedule, things might have worked out a little bit better instead of, you know, being creative on his terms. But, you know, that's a whole nother subject. I'm of the opinion that meetings cause more damage than good. Of course, it's nice to have that camaraderie and to get, you know, your friends together. And, you know, sometimes good ideas come out of that. But you can't force it. And I've been to hundreds of meetings in the workplace in my time, and they rarely accomplish anything. All they do is just waste time. And the most effective meetings I've seen were the ones where, you know, like the supervisors just talk. And when you let people chime in at meetings, You know what it always turns into? It always turns into bitch fests, complaining, and then, you know, nothing gets accomplished, and the meeting goes way over schedule. So, I can only assume that that's how things were with Violent J. Maybe they were better than that. Maybe they had good meetings, and maybe that's why he was so desperate to rekindle that flame. I don't know. Try to give people the benefit of a doubt, even if they're terrible people like Violent J. But that's besides the point. So, he also had Black Rain. And in my opinion, Black Rain is terribly underrated. It's a great album. Not everyone likes it. It's usually at the bottom of people's list as far as Dark Lotus albums go, and I think it's the best one. I mean, just about every one of these tracks are classics. And, you know, here they have the advert for ICP's, the second part of their Six Jokers card, Hell's Pit. So this is kind of what Dark Lotus originally became. They were like the gatekeepers of the Six Jokers card. You had a Dark Lotus album before Shangri-La, and then you had another one before Hell's Pit. So, I guess that was 2001 and 2004 when those two albums came out. So, 3-year difference, and then 4 years after Black Rain, we get the Opaque Brotherhood. And I remember at the time, a lot of Juggalos thought that they were going to follow a 4-year cycle for Dark Lotus albums. Like, it was a huge rumor that there was going to be a new one in 2012. And I'm just like, I remember debating this with people, like, where are you getting this from? Psychopathic, you know, very, very rarely drops surprise albums. It's because it's a gamble, and, you know, it's a business, and they don't want to just gamble on something that's not a sure bet. They want to market it. And they were marketing Death Pop at the time, and their ICP is like hyper-focused on Joker's cards. Whenever they're doing a Joker's card, nothing else matters. At all. Like, even recently, this year, you know, Violent J canceled almost an entire tour just because they weren't done with their Joker's card. That's the story. I think there's more to it than that, but whatever. You know, they lie about everything. They lie so much that, you know, everyone's used to it. And I personally have not caught Twiztid in a whole lot of lies. I think for the most part, they're honest about things. Maybe there's such a thing as a lie of omission, that, you know, you're lying if you leave out valuable information related to the context of what you're saying. And maybe they do that, but I personally haven't caught them flat out lying about a lot of things. ICP, on the other hand, lie all the time. They break promises all the time. So, you know, this could be 100% Twiztid's fault, but I'm not going to believe that because ICP lies so much and they break promises so much. And I'm just over it all. You know, let it be the past. Move on. We don't need another Dark Lotus album. We don't need another Dark Lotus tour. It's not going to happen. It shouldn't happen. We're better off, you know, them going their way, the other people going their way. You know, Killjoy Club has already, you know, basically died anyway. You know, we had one member of Killjoy Club pass away and another member leave for Magic Ninja. And I don't care what you say. Young Wicked was a member of Killjoy Club. You can retroactively change that all you want, but it doesn't change the fact that that's what they were doing. They put him in the group to promote him because Young Wicked was going to be the new Twiztid. He was going to be the new second banana on Psychopathic. He was a member. And now Killjoy Club's already down 2 members. Regardless. Dark Lotus is alive in the sense that Twiztid and Blaze are still representing and ICP is not. You know, but Twiztid's also moving on with their Venomous 5 project that they're doing with Alazul Ilu, and ICP is doing their thing, and we're better off for it. We don't need a new Dark Lotus. They don't want to do a Dark Lotus just because Juggalos are clamoring for it. You know, these 4 albums, they're going to be around for eternity. This is enough. Let it be what it is. You know, enjoy the music that's here. We don't need new stuff. Because if they were to get back together, it probably wouldn't even be that good anyway. But, you know, we'll probably never know. Regardless, that's about all I have to say on the subject. So don't forget to like and subscribe. Check back every day for daily content, because that's how we're doing it nowadays. Every day, man. Keep it moving. And catch you next Monday with a new Magic Ninja Monday. Peace out.